question. So what I am presenting now is the concept of in-gap band, and probably it is proper that I begin to explain which is this concept. First of all, let me say that this is the result of both theoretical and experimental work. The theoretical people are those that appear in the line below, and the experimental people are those that appear at the line just below my name. I am involved in both experimental and theoretical work, so I think that this lecture is going to be interesting for you all. Now, the in-gap concept was developed a bit more than 20 years ago by the professors Luque and Martí. And this concept is based in the following thing. If you have a valence band and conduction band in a semiconductor, in case that you introduce an in-gap band in between the two bands, the main bands, then it is possible to achieve the transition of an electron from the valence band to the conduction band, not only directly, but also in two steps, as is the case that you are seeing here. In such case, then it is possible to extend the range of photons in which you can observe a transition in this case by in the way that you can see here. And what this work shows is that it is possible to attain a very large efficiency. A maximum theoretical photovoltaic efficiency is about 63% in case that the main gap, I mean the one from valence band to conduction band, is about 195 electron volts, excuse me. Then in order to achieve this, it is necessary several requirements. In first place, no overlap of the in-gap band with conduction band nor valence band, because in that case you would have just a thermalization and you would obtain no particular advantage. Then it is also very important that this in-gap band is partially filled, because in this would allow to have the electron transition both from the valence band to the empty band, empty part of the in-gap band, and also from the filled part of the in-gap band to the conduction band. And also it is very convenient that you have a high concentration of dopant, so that you can have a high light absorption from through the in-gap band. And also if you get a delocalized band, this avoids this non-radiative recombination, as has been explained in different publications. Then our strategy for this has been always including transition metals which have partially filled 3D levels, so that with this partially filled 3D levels, in some cases it is possible to achieve the partially occupied in-gap band. So we have been studying different things along several years. For example, substitution of gallium by titanium in gallium phosphide allows you in this case to obtain this in-gap band, because this is the Fermi level, and then when you introduce gallium, you substitute gallium by titanium in this phosphide, it is possible to see that you can have a partially filled intermediate band or in-gap band, so that this allows to reach this situation. And this was published more than 10 years ago. But it is necessary to take into account that when you increase the concentration, as would be the case in this case, then you can get an overlap of the in-gap band with the valence band, which would imply that you can have no special good effect in this case. This is a case in which you make the substitution in the gallium phosphide, which is a tetrahedral semiconductor. Also, it is possible to make the substitution in this case by chromium, also of gallium, in the chalcopyrite copper gallium sulfide. And in this case, you can see that again we have an INGAP band which is partially filled by electrons, because this is again the Fermi level. And even in this case, when you increase the concentration of chromium, it is possible to see that you do not increase too much the width of the valence of the intermediate of the INGAP band, so that it is possible to achieve again, even when this high concentration of chromium, it is possible to increase to keep the good situation. Then we have here another example. In this case, vanadium is being substituted in indium sulfide, in indium Schottky sulfide. And again, we can see that this allows to have the partially filled INGAP band, because this is valence band, this is conduction band, and again the INGAP band is partially filled because this is the Fermi level. In all these cases, these are results of plain DFT, but we have in this case also studied what happens when you have a GW type calculation. And again, as you can see, with in the case of the GW approximation, which is a very good approximation for computing band gaps in semiconductor, you can see that again we have here the Fermi level, and it is possible to have again the partially filled intermediate band. Now, in this case, we have been fortunate in that we have been able to make a experimentally the substitution of vanadium in indium sulfide. And as you can see here, these are diffractograms. And in the case of the vanadium substituted indium sulfide, we can see that we have a mixture of two phases, the beta and the gamma phases of indium sulfide. But again, we have no hint of any independent crystallization of vanadium sulfide. For example, in the case of V2S3, is the situation would be here. And then we have been able to, further characterize this material, for example, with high resolution TEM. It was possible to verify that even in a single nanocrystal, the vanadium content is the same as that in the chemical analysis. And also we have seen that with the EPR, we have been able to verify that less than 25 of vanadium is in the vanadium 4 state, and most of it then must be in the vanadium 3 plus state, which is possible because we have been using vanadium 3 chloride for the preparation. And what is particularly interesting is that the photocatalytic activity in the degradation of aqueous formic acid, we have been able to extend the response to the in the photocatalytic activity, which is in this case measured with the rate constant of this reaction. And indeed, we have been able to see that there is an extension in the photocatalytic response. One could say maybe that it is just because of the decrease in the band gap, but we have been able to verify that this is not just a decrease in the band gap by using photoluminescence data. Then when you make the excitation with photons that have a higher energy than the band gap, then you can see that you can get the band gap energy photoluminescence, because in this case it is 2.0 electron volts, and this is very roughly equal to the wavelength of 600 nanometers. But what is especially interesting is that when you irradiate with photons that have not enough energy to excite the electrons from the conduction band to the band gap, then we do not see any effect when you have when we have indium sulfide pure, but when we have a vanadium doped indium sulfide, we see that we can have a photon up conversion because we are able to obtain the same effect with photons that have less energy than the band gap. And the most interesting thing is that this extension coincides exactly with the extension in which we have the increase in the wavelength range of the photocatalytic response. And this implies that indeed we have an up conversion because we are able to excite two electron volts with less than 2.0 electron volts. And this implies that indeed we have an up conversion as can be the case in the case of the in-gap band. Now, going now to the lead halide perovskites, it is necessary to comment that we have been doing previously other calculations of the lead halide perovskite band gap. When we use a hybrid functional that is fitted to the dielectric, the optical dielectric constant, and in this case, only when we have this alpha 0.19 is when we are able to obtain the proper band gap, as is very well known in the case of this lead halide perovskites, which in this case is the methylammonium lead iodide perovskite. Then we have been able to verify also other things. For example, we have been able to check with molecular dynamics the effect on the band structure. And as we can see, these are the results of the molecular dynamics study. And as you can see, there is a modification, a slight modification in the band gap in this case. And also we have been looking at how we can confine holes and not electrons in the case that when we have a ferroelectric domains, and this is the references where you can find these things in case that you are interested in this aspect. Now, the point is that going now to the chromine, to the chromium substitution, we have been studying the substitution of lead by, by chromium in this perovskite, and we have been able, on the one hand, to verify which is the geometry, and in the case that we have chromium, we have a shortening of the bond lengths in this case around the chromium, because the chromium is much less bulky than lead, while in the case that we have a chromium, we have an increase in the distance around the lead atoms, because the distance to the chromium from the iodine atoms to the chromium are being decreased. Then we have been studying with pure diffuse calculation, but of course always with spin orbit coupling included, because otherwise one would not be able to see any good effect. We have been studying the effect of just with DFT calculations, how we can have an in-gap band in the case of the substitution by chromium, and as you can see here, we have we would have here a new band induced by chromium, so that one can expect that maybe we have we can have an in-gap band. But then we have been doing again computation at the GW level, again with spin orbit coupling, and as you can see now we have an in-gap band which is crossed by the Fermi level and which is separated from the conduction and the valence band. Then what we have been able to verify is that if you do a rigid shift based on this GW calculation, then we have we do the rigid shift on the more detailed band structure, and as you can see here again we have an in-gap band which is well separated from the valence band and the conduction band, and in case that we have a lower substitution level by chromium, then we still have the same effect that we have an in-gap band crossed by the Fermi level, but then we have no problem even when we decrease the concentration of chromium. Then taking into account this thing, we have tried to verify if we could make experimentally this substitution by chromium. And what we have done is to make a mechanochemical synthesis substituting chromium bromide by chromium chloride, because chromium chloride, chromium dichloride is the only product that is commercially available, and in order to ensure that we have no strong misfit between the chloride and the iodide, we have made the substitution using lead dibromide instead of lead diiodide. And when we do this, we can see that we can have first of all, fully disordered crystal structure when we have a chromium, both when you have a when we have a chromium to lead 1-to-1 ratio, and also when we have a chromium to lead 1-to-3 ratio. Then, as you can see, there is no new phase appearing when we have a chromium, which ensures us that we have again a well disordered structure both in bromine and in both in the anion part and in the cation part of chromium to lead. Then we have been studying further these things. For example, we have been looking at the valence state of chromium using XANES technique, which is based on synchrotron radiation, and we have been seeing, we have been able to see that the position of the XANES jump is good to indicate chromium 2 plus and not chromium 3 plus, as would be the case, for example, here. And of course, nothing to do with the chromium foil, which has a shape, as you can see here. Indeed, what we see is that this position is the same as in the chromium dichloride. But then we have been also doing magnetic studies. Then, on the one hand, if you look at the product of the susceptibility and the temperature, which is the proper way to study magnetism, then you can see that there is a strong antiferromagnetic coupling here, but it is only up to about 50 Kelvin. When you go above those temperature, then you go into a paramagnetic domain, which is this case here. And indeed, the paramagnetic domain region is seen by this straight line here, which indicates clearly a paramagnetic behavior, while at lower temperatures, as you say, we have an antiferromagnetic coupling. This position of the antiferromagnetic transition is verified by the differential specific phase data that confirm the position of the antiferromagnetic transition. But especially what was more revealing is that we have had when we carry out the Curie-Weiss fit of this paramagnetic region, we see that the apparent effective magnetic moment is 3.6 magneton, more magnetons, while in the case of the theoretical prediction for chromium 2 plus is 3.5 Bohr magnetons. This means that, again, we can be sure that the chromium is in the 2 plus state and not in any other state like 3 plus, which, by the way, I must say that this is the what one could obtain by an oxidation in air of this this material. Because of this, we have been very careful to do all the preparation and all the characterizations using always the excluding always any contact with air. And then the what is particularly most interesting is that, as you can see, when we have chromium inside the material, we have a new feature that is not present in the case of the material that does not contain bromine. And also, it is very interesting to see that we have two features that here I see in an enlarged vertical sail, which are due to which appear when the, you have a chromium in the perovskite. And also, one can see that the amount of chromium. The amount of these features increase with the amount of chromium that we have here. This is not the case of this small peak at about 0.5 or 0.6 electron volts that are due to overtones of the lattice vibrations in the perovskite. So, and especially what is most interesting besides is that if you make the sum of the photon energies of these chromium-dependent features, these you can see that they are equal to the main band gap of this perovskite, which is about 2.35 electron volts. So this means that we are able to carry out both the transition from the valence band to the conduction band, which is to the from the valence band to the in the ingap band, which is the case of here, and also the transitions of electrons from the ingap band to the conduction band, which is the case of this small feature that we can see here. So this implies that the ingap band structure has indeed been achieved, and we are studying now how this material could be used in order to carry out some photocatalytic or photovoltaic advantage. But of course, for photocatalysis, the problem is that we would have to put the material in contact with air, and in that case, this would certainly lead to oxidation of the chromine 2 to chromine 3 plus, which is the most stable state. And indeed, we have been able to verify that when we expose this material to air in a matter of minutes, it changes color from nearly black to green, which is the typical color of chromium 3 plus. So we must now try to see how we can make this work in a photovoltaic system or in, or maybe in photocatalysis or in some other way, so that we can verify that this material is indeed behaving with the in-gap band structure. So with this, I finish my presentation. I must give thanks to all the financial resources that we have obtained. We have to give thanks also to the Spanish network of supercomputers so that we can have been able to use the CESVIMA supercomputer in Madrid. And also I can give thanks to the ALBA synchrotron that has allowed this synchrotron is in Barcelona, which has been able to access the station CLAES, which is a station for XANES and the XAFS experiments. And then I must also thanks to you all for your attention. And in case that you are interested in contacting with me, this is my email. Thank you.